We're ready to go.
Okay.
We're ready to go. Okay. Good morning, everyone. I want to call the innovation meeting for Thursday, November 30th, 2017 to order. With us here today, we have Councillor Baratti, Councillor Morantz, and hopefully Councillor Schreier.
Here he is.
Councillor Schreier is joining us here too. And also our clerk, Josie Marquise. So welcome, everybody. And we have a fun-filled day. We're looking at some business plans. So to get us started, we have some presentations. And are we ready with animal services yet?
Three minutes.
A motion for.
Go ahead.
Don't we need a motion?
Rich?
Oh, sure.
Okay, so now.
Councillor.
Perhaps I'm calling a motion.
Through that, good.
Minutes.
Oh, you got it.
Yes,
sir.
Yeah. October the 13th.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. You ready?
Okay.
All the minutes from the last meeting?
Yeah, I'll move that we approve the minutes from the last meeting.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, motion carried. Go ahead.
Hello, councillors. Thanks for having us today. So we have a brief power presentation regarding our budget for 2018, and we've simplified it. I know how people like simplified budget presentations, so I hope you enjoy it. So next slide. So every year, as you know, the city does a survey where they call people in the community and they ask, how satisfied are you with City of Winnipeg services? And for the recent survey that was done, 87% of respondents indicated they were satisfied with animal services. Next slide. As far as euthanizations, we're what's known as, and I've said this before, we're what's known as an open admission animal shelter. And what open admission means, in our terms, is we take in stray dogs from the city of Winnipeg, from the streets of the city of Winnipeg, not wearing licenses, from every type of dog, from the most aggressive dogs to the friendliest dogs, and everything in between. So our euthanizations will never be zero. But as taxpayers, you can be really happy because we've gone from 2008, and you've seen this kind of stuff before, 359 euthanizations a year, all the way down to 28 last year. We'll never be zero because we have some dogs that come off the street that are brutally aggressive that we can't safely adopt out to somebody. But our team of staff and volunteers does everything we can to drive close to zero as possible. Next slide. As far as license fees, the main driver of our revenue is dog licensing fees. And every year, Community Services does a jurisdictional scan for us to see how are we in regards to other major jurisdictions, in regards to licensing, in regard to mill rate support, in regard to the initiatives that our agency does. So right now, in 2017, we're $37 for a spay or neutered dog. As far as our mill rate support or our net mill rate support, we again did our jurisdictional scan. And for the budget year of 2018, it's $643,000 of operational mill rate support for animal services to do our operations. During our scan, we've added this new chart here where it shows what do those major jurisdictions have in regards to governmental operations. City of Calgary, their facility, their animal services handles dogs, cats, and they also have a governmental vet clinic with governmental veterinarians. Edmonton, same thing. Toronto, same thing. Hamilton handles dogs and cats. Winnipeg, in the city of Winnipeg, we just have a facility to handle dogs. We have a relationship with Red River College where they send their vets and their vet tech students for free, and they do all our vet checks for free. We use local vets in our community to spay and neuter our animals. And as you know, we have a contract with the Humane Society to handle cats. Next slide. As far as the gross mill rate support, so how much does it cost to do all the animal stuff, including the Humane Society? So it's been reduced again. And in 2018, it's been reduced to $1,295,000. Of that, 652 of mill rate support goes to the Humane Society, and 643 goes to animal services for our operations. Next slide. As far as our basic expense snapshot, this is one of our cool simplified slides that I hope everybody enjoys, but it shows what are our expenses and what are our revenues. So this slide is our basic expenses. So in most organizations, as you know, salaries and benefits are the biggest part of that expense budget. Other fees or other charges are going to be on our next slide. But with our facility that's located at 1057 Logan, which I know all you have been to, we rent that facility from the city of Winnipeg. The rent annually costs $215,000. Another big driver is our fix-it spay and neuter program. So as you know, half the cost of CAD licensing is going into a special area to help people in our community, especially low-income residents, have their cats spayed and neutered. So we allocate that much is allocated, which is a really good thing that the city of Winnipeg is doing to help the community. For our support services, community services bills us $176,000 a year for their support services. To rent our fleet from Fleet, we pay $129,000. For printing and postage, $121,000. That's mostly sending out invoices. We are being innovative very lately, and we've started with email invoices. So people are signing up so that we can save the city more money and help the environment by being green. And we're one of the first entities now, which are at the city, that are actually emailing license invoices. So we have a whole bunch of people that have done that, and more people are signing up. And it's a really good thing, a really good way to help us save the city more money and help the environment. And then also with corporate, so we pay the city of Winnipeg corporate, general corporate service charges of $87,000 a year. Our 2018 budgeted projected loss, of a loss for our first time in a while, is $18,622. Next slide. And then that other category, here are all the other elements that build into that other category. So everything from like vet fees, where we take our dogs to local vets to get them fixed, or the cost of the vaccinations or heartworm tests, or if a dog that's been in our facility for a while gets sick, we try and treat those animals. Uniforms, phones. One of the things we did this year to save the city more money is that all my managers got rid of their hard lines. So I don't have a hard line now, he doesn't have a hard line, and we are living and surviving just with iPhones. So if a customer has a question or whatever, I just use my iPhone for that, and it's saving the city a little bit more money. Next slide. As far as our revenue, the majority of our revenue is based on licensing fees, so pet licensing fees, dog and cat licensing fees. The other portion is the $643,000 of mill rate support. We get donations, so believe it or not, people will donate to the city of Winnipeg, which is a great thing, and it's tax deductible, so we're budgeting for $40,000 in donations. And then miscellaneous other revenue. Next slide. As far as our internal expenses, earlier we talked about the fees that were charged by general government charges from the city. And then community service charges, and that shows the trend of the charges, and then also from municipal accommodations or civic accommodations, which is for us renting the facility from the city. Next slide. This slide shows how when the SOA was created around the year 2000, right? Animal Services has been helping animals and people in our community for about 120, 130 years. We've been doing animal patrol forever. But it shows when the SOA was first created, almost 60-some percent of our budget was based off on mill rate support. So over the years, what's happened is while our budget is still climbing, which every city's budget climbs because of inflation, because of this and that. We're not paying the people the same we were 20 years ago. But the percentage of that budget now, only about 20% of our current budget is paid for by mill rate support, and the rest we have to make up through other areas. Next slide. And then warm and fuzzy slides, and we're almost over. How did I fly through this presentation or what? So we have lots of great community programming that we do. We like to emphasize that we help both people and animals in our community, not just animals. But we have newcomer programming. Top left is where regularly we go out to groups in our community like ERCOM. And you know, a lot of newcomers will come to our country and maybe they've had a lousy experience with dogs in their own country. Maybe they don't know what it's like to have animals as companion animals. And so what we do is we go to these groups and we'll do presentations on responsible pet ownership, how to interact with the dog. Some of these people have never touched the dog before, and it's always cute watching them interact with the dogs. Some of these people want to have absolutely nothing to do with the dog and say, get that dog away from me, and we appreciate that. But that's really fun, warm and fuzzy. We also go to ManyFest, top right, every year. That's, as you know, that's one of the biggest street festivals in the downtown. It's a great way for my team of staff and volunteers to interact with the community. So that's us at ManyFest. Cat licensing has been great. We have very good compliance with cat licensing. And we have two programs that we're running through the Winnipeg Humane Society through our contract with them. We have something called the SNAP program, where low-income residents of Winnipeg can go there, and for next to nothing, we're subsidizing the cat getting spayed and neutered. We also have a program that's emphasizing work out in the North End, the core Point Douglas areas, where we have a satellite operation there through our Fix-It program, which is the cat licensing program, where, again, you know, countless more cats are being fixed. And because won't it be great one day if we just drive down the cat population and there's next to no cats going into the Humane Society and groups like that. And then here we also go to malls very regularly. We'll set up, we'll talk about responsible pet ownership, we'll sell pet licenses. We have remotes that we bring, wireless card readers, so we can sell licenses everywhere at all these events. Next slide. This top left is Red River College. That's their team of veterinarians and their vet tech students that come out. So the nice thing with that is their students in this collaborative program get to work on all different types of dogs, from the friendliest dogs to the most aggressive dogs. They get to learn how to vet check them, give vaccinations, do heartworm tests, all those types of things in our setting. And then we get vet checks for free. We just have to pay for vaccines and stuff like that. So great collaboration. Top right here, we also have a relationship with Robertson College. Robertson has a vet office assistant category. They send out their students to, and they'll do programming through us. Bottom right here is we work this year with Manitoba Justice, and this is called their Spotlight Program, where Manitoba Justice sent at-risk youth who've been released from incarceration, really, and to integrate them back into society. One of the things is they come out and spend time with animals, and as we know, people who are nice to animals typically are nicer to people, right? And then the bottom left here is just every April, it's a Volunteer Appreciation Week in April. We give our volunteers nice certificates, and they enjoy it. Next slide. We also highly integrate with the media. We do everything we can to make the city of Winnipeg look good. If there's an opportunity to generate goodwill for the city, me and my team take it. Top left here is us going with Shadow Davis onto their show and bringing an Adopt-A-Pet on, talking about responsible pet ownership, licensing. Top right is CTV's coming to Animal Services. We're doing a morning remote talking about all the same topics. Bottom right is the Global Morning Show. We go on there regularly, probably every month or every other month, talking about responsible pet ownership, licensing. I'm trying to get on in mid-December to talk about should we or should we not give pets as gifts over the holidays and stuff like that. And the bottom left here, that was that story we worked on with CDC covertly when this person's dog, she lives in Lundar, somebody brought it to Winnipeg, it got adopted from Animal Services this year, it was a disaster, it was all over the media, and then we secretly actually got the dog back and then lied to her, and we drove north with CDC. And when we were there, I told her I lied. I said, I'm here really because I need to take a statement to get more information so I can help get your dog back. And the paperwork's in the back of the van. And when I opened the back of the van, I lied. There's no paperwork. And the dog jumped out. And she went crazy. And she's crying right there. And CBC took that picture of me while it actually happened. Next slide. And then adoption, so it's very nice that we have an adoption program so we can give these animals a second chance instead of euthanizing. Believe it or not, there are governmental shelters, especially in the states that don't have adoption programs, and they euthanize a lot more dogs. So these are all some of the dogs that have gone through our adoption program, and you notice top right, there's Krista, the head of legal services, who adopted one of our dogs recently, and that dog had been in our operations for more than a year, and she loves this dog. So next slide, you can ask her how Daisy's doing. And then next slide here, more education we do. The City of Winnipeg meter readers on the top. So every year before the meter readers go out, their team come to Animal Services and we give them education on how not to get bit when you go into somebody's home. We also respond, you know, some people go, why should I pay for my pet license? You don't do anything for me. Well, people need us just in case, in a rare event, they need our help. But we respond to house fires. We respond to police incidents. So if there's a house fire at 2 in the morning tonight and the fire and paramedic service need our help, we will respond to help those animals. So that's actually us responding to a house fire and helping the dog. And then also our outreach education. So if you see on the top right this slide here, me and my team have created this little education center in Animal Services. And half of that messaging on that table there is animal stuff, but the other half is social services stuff. Because a lot of times when my team are out in the community and animals are in crisis, guess who else is in crisis? Those the people who are taking care of those animals. So what we do is we have a lot of resources that we can actually give out to members of the community who are struggling and who are having problems. One of the things that we do give out that our officers have on board is this Manitoba 211. And Manitoba 201, they'll give a brochure, and if it's an awkward situation and the customer doesn't want it, but will tactfully leave it in their mailbox. And this is a resource where you can get help on food, housing, homelessness, mental health issues, all that kind of stuff. So we're really trying to do a lot, not only to help animals that are in trouble, but also help people that are in trouble. Next slide. And then we also get lots of donations. So this girl here, she had a birthday party. Instead of asking for a regular present, she asked for treats for animal services, came in. Here's a school in Fort Garry, bottom left, that did a big fundraiser for us and had a contest. It was actually a cake judging contest or something like that. So I sent my team out. I said, go judge the contest, pick out the best cake. And then we got a nice check, which was very nice. And then also our snow, in the wintertime, our snow piles up against a door you can't see on the right here. And because I'm so cheap, instead of actually paying to have it removed, we'll get volunteers to come out. And this is a whole team of volunteers that came out and shoveled the snow so we could actually open our front door into our play yard. Next slide. Last thing we do, we have animal control with 24-hour emergency response. We mostly handle dogs. As you know, our contract allows for cats to go to the Humane Society, so the city of Winnipeg does help cats and dogs. But, of course, if there's a stray rabbit, we're going to help the rabbit because we're animal lovers. If there's a stray bunch of ducklings, these ducklings right here on the top were actually in the Mandarin building in the courtyard. You know that pretty garden in the courtyard right there? Public Works called us that there was a mom and all these ducks that are about to run out in traffic. And again, we don't typically do these types of animals, but we're animal lovers. So we went out, we caught all the ducklings, nobody got squashed, and we actually released everybody, including the mom, by the river. We do handle exotics occasionally, so the occasional stray exotic that's running down the street or whatever, we handle those. And then there's our team, Westland. And that's it. That's my presentation. Any questions?
Councilor Schreier?
Thank you. About 8 slides ago, just 2 before the volunteer page, or 1 before the woman fuzzy page, as we refer to it, you show a graph, a line graph and a bar graph together. And one, the line graph is in red, that one, the proportion of revenue from a mill rate versus fees, is that?
What that is that showing in the olden days when the SOA was first formed, almost 60-some percent of our operation was paid for by mill rate or property tax support. Now, it's 20%.
Okay.
So the red line has gone down.
And the blue is the mill rate. Operational.
Well, that's our operational expenditure. So if you see that, let's look at 2000, whatever, these numbers are about our operational budget just to run animal services. I believe it's like $3,150,000 in that area. So of that $3,150,000, 20% is provided mill rate support from the city, which is $643,000, which is the budgeted for next year. So we have, in order to break even, we have to go from $643,000 all the way to $3.15 million, and we do that mostly through pet licensing. However, we're projecting a small loss for next year. Councillor.
Okay, so it's all meant to equal up to 100%, the blue plus the top of the red line?
Well, let's figure out go to the then there's something that makes any
sense. No, that's exactly correct. So basically the blue is our total operating expenditures, not including the Winnipeg Humane Society grant. So,
but that's your old expenditure. Okay, so then when you're at the red point, it suggests a surplus? I mean, at the beginning. When
all the red is supposed to signify is the percentage of our total operating expenditures covered by mill rate support.
Okay, so there's sort of like 2 separate graphs.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Any other questions? No? Okay. Thank you very much.
Councillors. Okay.
So now we're on to Winnipeg Fleet Management.
No presentation?
Okay. Right. And that's the only presentation we have, right? Nobody else had? Okay. All right, so now we're at the preliminary 2018 operating and capital budget details. Review. So. Do you guys would like to see everyone come up? Should we just do that under, how would you like to do that?
We want to come up now and
speak about the different things, their different business plans.
Yeah.
And because I think that includes some of their budget.
Yeah.
And then maybe a decision could be made on the budget. I don't know. It's up to the committee. I was anticipating presentations.
Okay. Okay, so maybe we'll just start with maybe animal services. Maybe we'll just start.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
We could also just move do the reports and then do it under reports.
Sure. Well, I want to move ahead with reports.
We'll move ahead with reports? Okay.
Sure.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. All right. So we'll do solar panel garbage and recycling compactor project. And I think they're looking for an extension.
That's right. And because we switched the meeting, I didn't have a chance to tell them to come over.
Okay.
We were waiting for that. But it's simply they're requesting an extension of time of up to 60 days.
Okay.
Any idea what the continued delay is? I mean, this actually came from the East Caledonia and Transcaledonia Community Committee back in January of this year. Mm-hmm. We were, you know, there's been an ongoing operating issue with the city continues growing and we need more public space. Garbage collection has been the issue. To minimize the collection costs, the idea was to use these compactors. So we pay a little more up front to get to at least try some of these innovative garbage bins so that we could hopefully lower our ongoing operating costs on the collection. Again, we were talking about 10, 11 months here just to see where we could go about trying these out.
In this case, Councillor Barotti, I think that our Director of Public Works is really handling this, and he's unable to be here right now. So in this case, we're hoping to...
Well, perhaps, we have Public Works tomorrow morning, and I'm also on that committee. Perhaps we'll bring it up at that time.
Okay.
Is there only one person in the whole hundreds of people within Public Works that could respond to this?
Well, that's what they asked for today, so...
Well, when's the next meeting? I'd rather get some answers sooner than later.
It would be in January, but mm-hmm. the schedule has yet to be approved, the council agenda, so it would...
Once in January, it'll be approved.
Okay.
And we did say up to 60 days,
yeah.
So if it's ready by then, we would put it on the January.
Okay, well, I'm going to move that we have this on the agenda for the next innovation meeting, whenever that happens to be.
So in 30 days, extension
sure.
time of 30 days?
That's what I'll move on that one.
Sure. Okay, all those in favor?
I have an issue of discussion. One thing we learned at council was that 60 days doesn't necessarily mean 60 days. We learned that 60 days can mean 45 days because 60 days implies two meetings from now. What I just heard is the next meeting's in January, so there's no meeting in December.
Correct.
Which means the next meeting, 30 days would mean more than 30 days, would mean January. So
it's one cycle. It's one cycle of meetings. 30
right.
days is considered. So this item will be on the January meeting as soon as council approves the schedule of meetings for next year. It will be in the January meeting, the first meeting.
So in this case, 60 days...
No,
the motion I've moved, regardless of what was recommendation from the public service,
okay.
I've asked for 30 days. They asked for 60. I'm saying I want to hear next meeting.
So 30 days in this case will probably mean 45.
No. They've asked for 60. I said no to the public service request to lay over for 60 days.
Okay, so
I move the motion
Schreier,
that's on the floor right
it'll
now.
It'll be on the next agenda item. There's
it'll
a motion
be more
on
than
the
30
floor.
Days.
Yeah. No, it'll be on the next agenda
oh,
item.
Yes.
Okay, technically it's more than 30, but it will be the January meeting.
Right.
I'm
just
okay.
saying.
So let's there's a motion on the table, please. All those in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Okay.
Sorry.
It's okay. All right, on to electric car charging stations. I think they're asking for an extension on this one, too.
30 days.
Okay, so that'll be on the next.
Still moved.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Okay, so now I guess we'll start with animal services. You're back up under the business plan.
Sorry, I thought we were...
Well, there might be questions.
Okay.
So we're looking at on the business plan for... The business plan and the capital, the 2018 capital budget. Is there any questions for animal services?
I'll just make a couple comments. I just
sure.
want to say, I mean, I see a lot of good innovation. I see a lot of, I know we've seen a really good pickup over the years since the SOAs existed and under your leadership with the number of licensed animals. the presence and, you know, the and I guess obviously the value that's provided to Winnipeggers and pet owners, I think, is being recognized. So I just want to say good work overall.
Thank you.
And I don't have any specific questions. I'll move the motion that we adopt the business plan and certainly open it up to further consideration and debate here.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Okay.
And just for committee information, recommendation 5 stays at the committee. And the other ones are being forwarded to, because it's the advisory board members, we actually have authority to approve that one.
Okay. All right.
Okay, I'll ask a question.
Sure.
So just, I was looking at table 4, actual and projected expenses. Looking at you got the 15 actuals there, $3,356,410, and then the 18 proposed, which was $3,804,522. And I'm just wondering if you comment on what the major drivers are of the difference.
Why is the difference?
Yeah.
Proposed and. So most of those are because of inflationary increases. So the cost, we have unionized employees, as you know, Councillor, and so there's bargaining agreements that corporate does that require us to give annual increases and steps to all our staff. Some of our costs that we incur as far as service charges that other departments charge us also typically go up incrementally. So.
Yeah, and if you look at the top line, it's mostly salaries, Councillor.
Yeah, I see that.
Is the forecast number inclusive of vacancy management?
Yes. Yeah. And then the one other one here, just it's a smaller line item, but yeah, materials, parts, and supplies, the 15 actual was 76,934, and the 18 proposed is 116. Comment on why those are jumping up.
So there, we'd have to follow up with you, Councilor, and get back to you. That could be, you know, we're getting, as you know, like when you see, you look at a police car and you see Toughbooks in them, you know, those Panasonic computers, I know that we're replacing them, we're working on replacing them this year. That's a big driver to our. Some of our costs, so we can follow up with the counselor with that online. You know, so with every business in the world, as we know, every business, including corporate here, costs go up every year. Inflation are usually because of salaries and benefits. What we tried to show on our slides there that our funding with mill rate support is not keeping up with that. So it's historically it's been going down. That was that one thing where it's gone from 60% when the SOI was first formed was funded by mill rate support. And then next year it's down to 20%. So the mill rate support is not keeping up where most departments, their mill rate support goes up annually to help, you know, cover those salary increases. Ours does not. And so what we have to do is we have to try and make up the difference whatever way that we can and respect the decision of our superiors. And so that's what we do. So I can tell you that my team and I and my volunteers do absolutely every single thing we can to keep our operation efficient. And when you look at that jurisdictional comparison with how much other cities are spending on their governmental operations, we're the lowest of the low, but we do also deliver the highest quality, and we have some of the highest licensing rates in all of Canada when you look at those other entities. So we're doing our absolute best. And I really do everything I can to save as much money as possible at our organization.
No, I appreciate that, and I think it's great. You're doing great work. Just one other question. I haven't trouble putting my eyes on it here. If it is here, it's just the FTEs.
They're all staying the same around the same 20, in the 27 area. And that 27 FTEs, so that means if you came to Animal Services today, you're not going to see 27 people. It's just full-time and part-time. And Councillor, while we were just chit-chatting there, that increase in materials and parts was due to, it was due to an IT thing where we purchased something called Chameleon, which is, it's a software platform that manages all our financial piece and also manages our animal stuff that we do. So when they go onto that tough book, it's a modernized program that manages our operations. So that's what that was.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Councillor.
Councillor Shine?
Thank you, Chair Gilroy.
Where my computer's not on, so I'm sort of looking at Councillor. Oh, thank you. You were referring to the one you were referring to regarding salaries and materials. Salaries and benefits, 1.6 million to 1.9 million. And then.
Well, that's projected 2020.
Oh, okay. Excuse me. It's predicted 18.
This is 15 actual.
15 actual, 1.7 to 1.8 in 2018, projected in 2018.
Yeah.
So 1.7 or 1.8 or 1.65 to 1.82 over 4 years. It's not a big percentage increase. It's not much more than 10% over 4 years. Materials, you said due to changes in salaries, collective agreements, materials, parts, and supplies. But when it comes to materials, parts, and supplies, that could be due as well to increase in costs, salaries. But we have no control over that. That's just what we pay for those, if you will, that are just contracted, if you will, or just purchased, independent of our in-house collective agreements. But that's up at about a 50% increase in 4 years. So I see that being the largest percentage increase. It's not a large...
No, Councillor, that's because we bought a software package.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you bought the software package. I'm just trying to look because there's two big jumps. 106 in 2015. 107,000, 225,000. So that was a jump. The projected. So you bought the program that's projected for 2018, or
it was bought in 2014, 2015. That's where you see the big jump.
2014 to 2015. Okay, so 2014, 2015. We see 107,000 in 2015, and then a jump to the actual for 2016 is a big jump of 18,500. These are not large costs. I'm just looking at percentage increases. So the software was purchased in 2014, which would show up in the 2015 actual. Okay. And then the 25th, then is an 18,500 jump. And then another 7,000, and then another jump of another 19,000. So, again, a 50% increase over 50%.
That category is not just software, though. It includes a number of things like dog food, animal drugs, vet supplies. But there was that large increase in 14, 15, 16 was due to the introduction of the ERP program.
So you bought the, what program, sorry?
It's like an enterprise program, kind of like PeopleSoft, but it's designed just for kennels.
So that was purchased over a few years then?
It was implemented in 2014, 2015.
Okay.
The actual cost, it did probably flow in two periods.
Okay.
Fair enough. We're going to turn your computer on.
Thank you.
So
I guess my point is, because the point was, increases due to salaries, and then there's increases due to, I guess in this case, what one could call capital costs. And so I'm just curious to see how that fits in. But you'll bring back a report at the next meeting, or?
No, we're done, I think.
Yeah, this is the business plan, their annual business plan, and their operating budget for 2018. So that's what we're doing right now.
Okay, but Councilor Morantz did ask the question about
If there's other questions, they can definitely, you can offline
with
them.
I answered Councillor Rance's question already, what the main driver in that category was. That was what his question was.
Oh, I thought you said you'd get back to us.
Figured out while we're sitting here.
Oh, we're sitting here. I see. Okay.
Like when you say you look at a police car or a fire truck or an animal services van and they have a tough book, a fire truck has a Panasonic tough book in it, a police car has a Panasonic tough book in it. pass out topics of very expensive pieces of hardware. All of these services across North America use them because if you drop them, they pick them back up and they work, right? Mm-hmm. Every one of those platforms from the police, fire paramedics, ambulances have toughbooks too. Animal services vans have toughbooks. They have software packages. So the police have spent money on their software package. Fire has, and we have too. Chameleon is a very progressive program where cities like Calgary use it. You're welcome, counselor, to come see it if you like. And it manages not only the animal processing, animal sheltering, but also has a module where it manages our financial piece, and it also manages our volunteer program too. So it's a very commonly used program across North America in governmental animal shelters.
Thank you. So that was paid for, I guess, by 2017. So the reason for the projected 2018 increase of another $18,500, I guess, over a 10% increase, that's due mainly to increases in the number, the amount of materials, parts, and supplies, or would you say it's inflation?
The 2018 increase?
Yeah.
The 2018 increase, there was an additional allotment for the software package where we were exploring the option of an online payment site provided by the ERP providers at Chameleon. Currently, we do have an online website where we pay a substantial amount, and we're looking for possible efficiencies by using this link package.
Okay. So the main reason for the increases over what's shown here over the term is for materials, parts, and supplies, the main driver for the increase in cost is software.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. All right.
And I just have to reiterate that look at our attachments for our jurisdictional scans. And when we're talking about, you know, little things like this, there's other cities that are spending millions and millions of dollars on animal services agencies. That doesn't say that if I need to buy something, I'm going to go look at Giant Tiger next door to see if it's cheaper, okay? So I do everything I can to save money and keep these numbers lean. Our main drivers are salaries and benefits, which are aligned, which corporate, which is right here, mandates that we pay. So we have no flexibility over that. But
and I also just want to really thank you, because I always do appreciate the warm and fuzzy. Sometimes we always hear about, you know, the bad stuff regarding animal services, and I know that you guys are doing a wonderful job. So thank you for all you do, and keep up with the good work. Thanks.
I want to make the point. I don't even know how they found you. You're like perfect.
That's very nice.
People you work with.
Thank you. Yeah. Okay. Who was the counselor that said I'd probably do this job for free? That was Maze.
That's right.
Maze said that.
Yeah.
You would probably do the job for free.
Like, all right. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Winnipeg Fleet.
So did you want to move the motion?
Can somebody move the motion?
Okay, I thought we voted on already, but yes.
Yeah, we did actually. You're right. We did, and there was questions afterwards.
Okay,
correct.
So, Councilor Burwati,
so fleet management. Welcome. So is there anything you wanted to maybe highlight in this year's business plan?
I think we could give you some key highlights that we're working on this year, sure. Right. We're coordinating an operational review of the agency. None of that never has been done in the agency. This will help us find further efficiencies, how we compare to other agencies across Canada. It'll also tie in with our future new head office and repair manufacturing relocation, the basis of estimate. Utilizing the automatic vehicle location systems to assist in fuel usage and improving service levels through user advisory committee departments. We're going to proceed with the approved innovative capital funding project for all electric vehicles and supporting infrastructure. There were two vehicles and two charging stations approved. We'll also be conducting a review of how the agency covers operating costs in order to accurately reflect the repair and maintenance cost relationship with fleet asset age. Some key things we'll be working on this year.
So can you just talk a little bit about the electrical vehicles, because that's a huge thing, I think, for fleet, and
sure.
How you're going to be able to see how that fits in with your other
Yeah, all electric vehicles is new to the city. We've never had electric vehicles. We don't know what the challenges are, the barriers, implementation costs, maintenance costs, how are they going to fit within the department's operational feasibility, usability. This will also tie in with the bigger picture of the electric car recharging. I also help feed that. We can advise on that to help that move forward or answer any questions. So actually, we're pretty excited about this. The first, we'll probably have Parking Authority helping us with one, and we'll be finding another city department to use. And again, we want high use. We want these things out there. We want to make sure that they work for us and they work for our clients.
Is there any other questions?
Well, I mean, obviously, it's a bit of an investment to put up the charging station. It's a bit of an investment to get the initial vehicles going. What are you hearing from other municipal users in other jurisdictions?
Definitely reduced maintenance costs.
Okay.
It's probably the, I think it's like 30% of what a normal vehicle is. Emissions, there's zero emissions, which is good for the environment, good for the business.
And operationally, charging times. Like, I mean, we've got a network of gas stations that we own and operate, and that fleet deals with, of course. But what kind of implications do you see here in terms of charging times?
There's actually three levels of charging stations. There's a level one, which is residential, charge at like 8 hours. There's a level two, which is like 3 to 5 hours, and the one floor is a level three, which is half an hour.
Okay.
So then, somebody high use during the lunch, plug in, charge up, then go for the rest of the day.
But they'd have to come back to one central station for the level three. So you're having lunch every day wherever that station is. Okay.
As we can expand, if this doesn't work out, we can expand those charging stations. Mm-hmm. And then, hopefully, yeah.
Councilor Schreier?
Your voltages, 120, 240, and 480. Like, what's your level three voltage?
Good question. I think it's 280, 240.
240 is your level three?
Yeah.
What's your level two?
Level two is on the testing.
Maybe your 110,
120. Level two, good question.
Okay. The mechanics, so this is all repaired in-house with your mechanics. So you've already, how are you dealing with your transition for your mechanics to be educated over dealing with the electric vehicles?
Actually, we're working with Red River College.
Okay.
They did one course for us on hybrids. We'll be working with them on doing a course for electric vehicles as well, and they're very excited about doing that, working with us on that.
Any other questions?
I do have one more question. It's about the hybrid, because we're in this, hybrids, I believe, will always have a place in this century in northern climates and intercity transportation. When it comes to maintenance of hybrids, are they more complicated than a regular gas engine vehicle?
The basics are there, like the brakes and the car itself is. The only thing that you've got to be careful on is the battery portion of it. There you need step and space safety measures, and a lot of that stuff we still send out to the dealers because we just haven't got enough of them in the fleet yet. Through last year's 2017 business plan approved by council, we've now going to be buying hybrids and SUVs. That's the standard now. So as we increase, we'll get more, but as far as maintenance costs, everything is normal, like a normal vehicle, just when you come to the battery system.
Okay. All right. Seeing no other questions, does anyone want to make a motion?
No, I'll move that we accept the fleet report.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Carried. Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay. I want to take Parking Authority.
Good morning, councilors.
Morning.
Morning. Colleague.
Yeah. Good morning. Want to give us some highlights?
Certainly. On the executive summary, I just wanted to touch base on our 2018 business plan goals that we have. First one being evaluate current and emerging payment method technologies and marketing mobile payment options. That's certainly making reference to our use of the Pay by Phone mobile app, which we're seeing a tremendous uptake, especially since we've taken over the convenience fee. And that really plays into a bigger strategy down the road with helping to develop a strategy to continue to reduce our operating expenses regarding meters and trying to put a bigger emphasis on using a mobile device versus the old hard pay stations. So that's really playing well, and it's certainly we're getting seeing a tremendous uptick on it. So I'm pleased to see that. So we're certainly going to continue to market this for the following year, 2018. As you know, the number two MBA POA bylaw screening and collection consolidation, the Winnipeg Parking Authority has taken over all the screening process and adjudication for all the other agencies in the city of Winnipeg. We have forecasted, I think, that we'll be able to manage that with our current staffing, but again, we're not sure without any data how that will actually impact the operation. So we will be collecting all that data throughout the year and making sure that we meet the needs and we don't have any backlogs built up because of higher demand. So certainly something that we're going to be performance managing and tracking very closely throughout the year. Number three, our collaborate with key stakeholders and engage in consultations in relation to on and off street parking. In the budget, there is a request for $200,000 for public consultation regarding parking. If that's approved, then certainly we're looking towards working with our Office of Public Engagement to initiate those public consultations to deal with on and off street parking as a whole. Great opportunity for us. And lastly, leverage technology and operational efficiency to ensure we may remain self-sustaining. Certainly councillors are aware that we are completely self-funded and do not receive any tax support at all. So we're always looking for ways to continue to remain self-sustaining. And you know, one of the couple of the points that we're really focusing on for the efficiencies, expanding the use of our ALPR equipment, for example. You know, recently, you saw last night that we're now moving into using some of the ALPR technology to help Public Works in the enforcement of snow routes, overnight snow routes. So those are types of efficiencies that we will certainly see help reduce our operational costs. Also, the intuitive routing software that the Innovations Committee gave us funding for, I can tell you now, is fully in place. I invite you all to come down to the office and have a demonstration. It's absolutely pretty brilliant software. So in conjunction with ALPR and better routing, we certainly look to be not only look at this as being a greener initiative. It certainly reduces our costs as we move forward. Moving over to some of the highlights for comparisons for our adopted 2017 to our preliminary 2018 budget. The biggest piece that we can focus on is the revenue change with regards to the dollar increase of meter rates across the board, as well that we've made a recommendation to reduce the 50% early payment discount down to 25%, which will certainly increase the revenue. Some expenditure changes. We have put in a transfer of $5 million from the land operating reserve. As well, there's a dividend to the general revenue fund in an amount of $4 million, which is the combination of the dollar meter increase as well as the reduction of the early payment discount. And also can mention that there was a $600,000 repayment on the Longboat loan that was given to them a number of years ago. So overall, there's been a change from year over year of about $9 million in our dividend to for this coming up year. Lastly, just want to touch on as far as the salary and budget and vacancy management. We're following in line with the corporate initiative, so we will be looking to put in savings of about $52,000 for salaries. There's been a slight variance up on our current salaries. Again, my fellow CEOs mentioned the just inflationary costs of salaries and contracts. That's what is driving that. And if you have any other questions, we're certainly open to answering it for you.
Councillor Shire?
So we're talking about a demonstration of what software?
It's an intuitive routing software that the Innovations Committee Fund had provided funding for us to install. It is currently up and running now, and certainly welcome to come down and have a view. Really, in essence, what it's doing is gaining through our data and past history. It's producing most efficient enforcement routes. It's actually doing a really a cool process again for efficiencies. It's mapped out all of our snow routes, so each night, for example, the officer would get into the vehicle, plug his little fob in. It would take them out onto a snow route and do a turn by turn, so that they're actually covering all of these snow routes each night. So when they don't finish from that night, the computer will certainly install back into the routing for the officer for the next night. So we're getting most efficient coverage of the snow roads. Again, it's important to support Public Works, and they're keeping those high priority routes clear of snow and for traffic and bus traffic in the mornings.
Perfect. Councilor Barotti?
Thank you. All this new technology and being able to better enforce the snow routes is a good thing, and you suggested all snow routes could be done potentially every night. My concern is, if you somehow miss the fact or you're in from out of town, that the snow routes are now applied from December 1st and 2 a.m. to 7 a.m. as we all know, when we've got the apps and all sorts of great technology. But if you were not aware, I'm just concerned that because you're not getting a physical notice under your windshield, could you get a ticket on Monday, then on Tuesday, then on Wednesday, and then on Thursday, and then say by the end of the week you start getting them in the mail in consecutive days? Is there some control in place to ensure that the first time you get a mail ticket, you're not issued one each and every day?
Well, and certainly, like anything, Councillor, we do usually put warnings for the first week. I can tell you that in this instance, for the annual snow route, for the last about 2 weeks, our officers have been going around on those particular snow routes and putting a brochure on to remind people that it is coming. So I think we go above and beyond to certainly get that message out. We don't want to penalize. Also, I mentioned before, and I'm sure you're aware, Councillor, we're one of the few cities in North America that allows our officers to give a curbside warning. So I would expect that if there's someone from out of town, the officer would again issue a warning ticket so that that individual would get that piece of education. Now, if they continue night after night after night parking, once they've received it, well, certainly there may be further escalation. To
I'm just worried about consecutive days, where you've, is there, the first time you get one by mail, you get it, and that's fine. I have no problem. If you're, I leave my car out next Thursday, overnight, I get a ticket. If it happens again the very next day and I haven't even received the first ticket, I've missed the fact that there's a snow route. That's where what I'm getting at here, because we're mailing them out now. If you've got one under the windshield and you do it again the next day, it's like, that's your fault because you had that physical notice there. You might not have received the thing in the mail yet for your first one, and it could happen in consecutive days. You've changed your pattern for some reason, like you've had a house fire and you're staying at Granny's house and it happens to be a snow route. An ugly circumstance like that, for example, where you're changing your normal pattern midway through the winter. I know you guys are very good about warning people that it's coming, first-time warnings and such. Again, just changing to this new mail process, I just want to make sure everything's been thought through to avoid, literally, 5 days' worth of tickets in a row before,
There is a control mechanism in there that accounts for that timing issue.
Okay.
So if it goes out, we won't necessarily mail out the next night on the same streets, same route that we get. So we've tried to account for, a few days' worth of timing on the mail out. So.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Any other questions?
No, just maybe one quick one. I'm just looking at a couple of the slides in the report under financial. I just think it's an interesting, there's a comparative analysis here across jurisdictional analysis of revenue per parking space and then revenue per 100,000. It looks like we are, based on the cities here, we're the lowest of all of these cities. What's the significant? I don't see a page number. It's
three quarters of the way down the bar on the 2018 business plan.
Page 14. Revenue per parking.
So Montreal is 14 million. per 100,000, Toronto's 6.4 million per 100,000, the average is 3.9 million per 100,000, where 2.2 million per 100,000. But if I guess to extrapolate, I mean, if we're about 700,000 people, does that mean our revenues are 15, 16 million, something like that?
So this is based on 2015's MBN data. So it's now, we have 2016, but it hasn't been finalized and approved yet. So a little bit difference, but part of this is accounts for the size of the demand area for parking. Montreal is a very dense downtown parking district, has lots of spaces. Part of what's affected Winnipeg is reduction in on-street spaces, reduction in off-street spaces. We've had the Winnipeg Square Parkade sold. We've had the Civic Parkade closed. So we've had a reduction that's affected our revenue. One of the things you will see with the dollar an hour, plus we haven't had an increase to parking in a very long time. The high demand area was created in 2012. So now we're getting a parking increase, which will help that number come up a bit. So.
I do see on another page related to that. That was page, which page was that?
Oh, I guess it was page 18.
Yeah, so page 17, so page 16, it shows compliance, and it shows the number of citations issued per 100,000 population. That one's based on 100,000 population. If you look at this graph, it's amazing. If you look at the number of citations issued per 100,000, it's a very similar graph. And again, on this one, Winnipeg is among is the second lowest in terms of number of citations issued per 100,000. Montreal and Toronto are the highest. Winnipeg's down there with Hamilton, and you can see the correlation between those two graphs. They're very similar. So it looks like Winnipeg just has one of the lowest number of citations per 100,000, and it correlates incredibly with the amount of revenue per 100,000. Having said that, Councillor Berwati mentioned that you did mention, sir, indoor parking lots, and that sort of changes things.
I'm sorry. Just on revenue that we've had. We had the closure of the Civic Parkade, which affected our revenue a few years ago. We had the sale of the Winnipeg Square Parkade several years ago that affected revenue. So some of the things have affected revenue. That's the actual payment. The other piece to the revenue side is citations.
And really, and on the citation piece, I mean, it's difficult. This is one of the key pieces that are difficult because each city is different with their bylaws, their time restrictions. You know, certainly our city has the officers the ability to issue the warning ticket and work. We really want to work with the citizens. So if you do come back to your car, to your generator, you know, once you move your vehicle, you're not going to receive a ticket. A lot of other jurisdictions will, no questions asked, you're 2 feet into a fire hydrant zone, you're getting a ticket. So that number is always a difficult one to do an actual comparison on. And I think because we do allow our officers to have that ability to issue a curbside warning, we have a really good balance of striking that public education piece with actually issuing a ticket. So, you know, I think we're well in the middle of really being not punitive, but more on the side of compliance versus strictly punitive.
I take a look at the graph in the cities employed, aside from Hamilton, which is about, I don't know, 20,000 less than Winnipeg or something like that. The other cities are larger, notably larger than Winnipeg, 50% larger to, five times larger, whatever. But it's all questionable. It's like on the edge, like in terms of proportion of population to number of indoor parking lots. And I'm not saying that's your responsibility to have these answers, but do you think Winnipeg has a slightly higher number of parkades than the other cities in proportion to the population? Hard to say.
No, it would be hard to say. Like Toronto, for example, I know, I know very closely the Calgary Parking Authority. We do a lot of work with our colleagues over there. They drive to build a lot of their own and become leaders of off-street. As mentioned earlier by my colleague Grant, that we over the year our off-street, whether that's parking facilities or surface parking lots, have been sold off, so that we don't have a very high off-street presence it would be difficult to comment. I mean, I know the rest of the private operators, that there's certainly, I don't think our city's any less as far as the natural number of parking facilities versus parking lots is something that I could comment any further on.
Fair enough.
All right. Any other questions? Great. Seeing none, does somebody want to make a motion?
Sure. I'll move we receive the you concur in the recommendation.
Okay. Yeah. All those in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone.
Winnipeg Golf Services.
Yep.
Now, before we get started,
yes.
We have to announce.
Oh.
So everybody knows.
Oh, thank you.
Al Shane is going to be retiring, so this is his very last last business plan.
3 to 45.
He's doing your retirement golf.
That's what I told him. He's got to take up more golfing.
Going to get a fishing rod. Thank you,
Councillor. You're welcome.
Congratulations.
Well, thank you for all the years of service that you provided the city of Winnipeg. Okay, do you want to give us a brief highlight?
Sure. If we just go right into the executive summary, which is really the meat and potatoes of the business plan. Always biggest interest for Golf Services is rounds played. It's our obviously our biggest revenue generator. This year we were down 6.3% over the 2016 season. Normally that would be setting off panic buttons with me, but this year it was self-inflicted. I believe, as we mentioned last year, we were going to implement a new strategy whereby we were going to look at opening the golf courses later in the springtime and close them earlier in the fall time, which are our shoulder seasons, which our new POS system has shown us that that's where we have the highest amount of expenses with the least amount of revenues. So those shoulder seasons are obviously very weather dependent. By opening, we incur a lot of costs with bringing on our staff. So it made sense for us to do that. So I didn't panic over the rounds played because it did generate a saving on our salary side right now of approximately $200,000. So when we looked at the numbers yesterday, that we were $200K under our budgeted amount for the 2017 season. So our plan did come to fruition. And moving along, we were continuing with our capital improvements. As you're aware, we have a capital improvement fund, which is funded by $2 per green fee that goes into the reserve account. Michael, correct me on my terminology always. So in 2017 at Windsor Park, we looked at our infrastructure. We worked on our clubhouses. We purchased some chairs and improved the aesthetics inside the clubhouses with carpeting. We improved some air conditioning, and we did some work in our kitchen area, and we also built a new front entryway and included some railings for handicap accessibility. So those doors are now handicap accessible. At Kildonan, we did a little bit of in work on the interior as well. We improved by improving the air conditioning, the HVAC systems. We replaced some roofs on our buildings, on our maintenance building, and we went out on the golf course and improved the playability of the golf course. We're on hole 7, 9, 14, and 16. We improved the drainage, and on hole 16, we built a secondary tee box. And on number 4, we also renovated, on 16 and 4, we also renovated the existing tee box in number 4 as well. For 2018, we're looking at Kildonan Park, improving the clubhouse carpeting, some tee box rebuilding, and at Crescent Drive, we're looking at doing work on replacing the parking lot, which we, since the introduction of Thermia, we have found it to be far too small for our current needs. Also important is our fees will go up in 2018. We're looking at $1 per fee increase on 18 hole rounds and 50 cents per round on the first round at the 9 hole courses, Harborview and Crescent Drive. I'd just also like to mention that stepping back a little bit, at Kildonan, where we've also in 2016, built a new back entryway and made that building handicap accessible. We're currently working on a lease agreement with Cross Country Ski Association of Manitoba to begin operating not just at Windsor Park, but also out of Kildonan on a limited basis, whereby we will now be offering handicap skiing, which is something that we couldn't do quite as well at Windsor Park because of the terrain, but Kildonan, I'm told, is perfect for it. So that we're hoping to bring a report forward in the next few weeks for the approval of the lease agreement with CANSI. We have, of course, our line of credit. So if you look at page number 2, the agency's line of credit is projected to decrease from 687,016 to 6,200,000 in 2018, and contributing to the decrease will be mill rate support of 730,000 from the city. This represents the fourth of 10 payments of 750,000, which we were required to pay the outstanding balance, with net of vacancy management 20,000. So rather than it be 750,000, it will be 730 this year. Each of the 10 annual transfer payments will be for 750, and the transfer will be less due to the closure of the Gulf Coast Reserve Fund and the equity balance transfer to the City of Winnipeg Special Operating Agency. Other than that, there's not a whole lot else to report regarding golf services. It was just pretty much a standard year. Weather was cooperated in some ways. We had a good latter part of the year, and that drove our revenues, but the start of the year was poor. We were late to opening, which was good because a lot of golf courses opened prior to us and then they had to close because we had snow. So that's where some of our savings came in. And then May was kind of cold and things got better in June and revenue started to go up. Any questions?
Questions? Councillor Schreier.
Thank you. I believe the Winnipeg golf courses are the only golf courses left in the city that don't use electric golf carts. Given that we've had electric golf carts for decades, and the city's just gone into creating the infrastructure for electric vehicles for streets, is there any plans for converting our, if you will, the golf cart fleet to electric?
Councillor, that's a good question. We've had electric carts. We were at one time, when the SOA was first created, moving towards a model whereby we were using completely electric carts.
We were.
What we found was, and being a business and making business decisions and trying to cut costs, that the electric cart is far more expensive to operate on a long-term basis than a gas cart. The batteries on them, we found, are very expensive to replace. Each cart carries approximately 6 to 8 batteries, depending on the model. As we got to the end of their life cycle, we also found we were losing revenue because the carts couldn't go out more than once a day. We'd send the cart out in the morning with the seniors. It would come back in. We'd have to charge it up for 3 or 4 hours. So we lost those revenue opportunities. So when we looked at what we were paying in cost, the impact it had on the service that we were able to provide to our customers, in comparison to gas, we started moving back towards gas cars. It's purely a business decision.
Okay. I used to play a notable amount of golf between the ages of 15 and 25, and I remember when the electric carts were coming out at that time. And I could surely see back in the 80s was that the time you're referring to in the
no,
city?
It was more in the 2000s.
2000s, you went all electric and you reverted back to gas cars?
Well, we didn't go completely electric. We were moving towards that model.
Okay.
I'd say we were probably around 50% of our fleet were electric at that time.
Okay.
And we just found they were so problematic for us. Okay. If they weren't plugged in properly overnight, if you had a power shortage, if you had something that affected the charge, that cart wasn't going out, that's $30 that we lost. And we actually started, it multiplies more, Councillor, because a lot of our seniors who require the carts, if that cart isn't available for him, he doesn't play. So I lose the revenue from the auto cart, and I lose the revenue from the green fee.
And it seems unfortunate timing, because it seems like when you're doing this, it was just before the advent of the feasibility of electric vehicles on our roads, which has only been in the last, 12 years. But they're only getting more efficient and more efficient all the time. Would one consider that now, given what we're doing, especially for the feasibility of electric vehicles and for the city to bother putting in infrastructure for to be involved with creating the infrastructure for electric vehicles, that it's a good time to reconsider now that the city's, not just the city, but society.
You're absolutely right.
And the technology.
You're absolutely right about infrastructure. That's another thing about electric auto parks, is you need to have charging stations. So I have to have a building that's dedicated to auto parks, so we can park them inside and keep the chargers. You can't just put a charger outside.
Sure.
All right. So now that means that if we continued to on the path we were on before, we would be looking for money to build new barns to house auto carts. Right now, we built a fenced in area, for example, at Kildonan. We park them in that area. So I understand fully where the world is moving with green, and I agree with it. But again, from a purely business perspective, and my role is to make the best business decisions for golf services, that one financially, from a financial perspective, from a customer service perspective, just doesn't work. It just doesn't work for us.
But that could change as society, as technology changes.
And the
private golf courses, how do they work it out?
Well, they built in their infrastructure. I guess they've raised their fees to build their buildings. I can't really speak for those golf courses. I can only speak for ours, and they were very, very problematic for us. And given that auto parts are our number two source of revenue,
Okay.
We want to generate as much of that as we possibly can. Very much like animal services, Leland said, we're trying to cut everywhere we can, and we're trying to squeeze every dollar out of everywhere we can, and making sure that we have a reliable auto cart fleet. So, for example, on Thursday morning, when our 100 seniors show up, we know that we're going to be able to provide them with 50 working cars.
Okay. Councilor Morantz has a question.
It's a very interesting discussion because, the idea of electric carts just seems to, you know, before I heard what you said, it seems to make a lot of sense in this day and age. I mean, they're everywhere, mm-hmm. except, I guess, on our court. Do we have any?
No. I think we sold off the last one about 2 years ago.
I'm wondering if it might be worthwhile having a more in-depth examination of that particular issue. I don't know if we can call for that here. Or how that would go forward, but I would be interested in having a more of a sort of a written explanation of the pros and cons of the idea of electrification. Just to see, like, this is really the first time I've heard the issue discussed like that, and it never even occurred to me that from a business perspective, from the city, it just didn't make any sense. And I appreciate Councillor Schreier raising the issue here today. And given the fact that this is the Innovation Committee and we have now a Chief Innovation Officer, it would seem to me to be timely to maybe have a look at that.
I sure do.
Yeah. So do you want to make a...
Well, given that my colleague raised the issue, I'd be happy. Do you want to move something?
Thank you.
Probably just a separate motion.
Would that be a new business motion?
New business? Okay.
Okay. So we'd have to suspend the rules. Mr. Schreier,
would we do this now?
Yeah,
you
can
okay.
do that now.
All right. I'm amenable to any friendly amendments or whatever, but the idea would be for the therefore clause being that there's not a department, but we have a head innovations.
There's something that the public service report
public service.
On the viability for golf services or something like that. Mm-hmm. Something simple
okay.
like that.
All right.
Does that make sense to me? I still move.
Okay. All right. All those in favor?
I don't know. How long would it take?
60 days?
90 days.
90?
90 would be better.
Okay. Especially since I was retiring. And it'll be someone else. That's,
yeah. That is a...
Yeah.
I call that a friendly amendment, so moved.
Okay, for 60 days. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
It was 90.
Sorry, 90 days. Sorry. 90 days.
That's the first time Councilor Morantz and I have worked together on a motion.
There you go. Okay.
Thank you, Councilor.
And Councilor Schreier was the mover. Okay.
Yes.
So there, is there any other questions on the business plan that's in front of us here today?
No, I mean, it's indicative of the golf universe. I mean, it, 4 hours plus now in today's day and age to go for a round of golf, less and less people doing it. I mean, I recognize why this year we chose to cut expenses and, you know, we're not too alarmed by the reduction in rounds played, and that's fine. Just there's a big supply of golf in this market, and we, I remember the golf report we had out of the group out of Denver a couple years ago. It just showed the trend and what's expected. And we're competing against private courses. It doesn't necessarily make sense, but that was the decision of most recent council. But I'll move, I guess, the recommendation here.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
Perfect. Thank you.
So now we go back to the 2.3. Okay. All right. Does somebody want to move the preliminary 2.3?
Councilor, can I say something before?
Sure. Oh, absolutely. Sorry.
I'd just like to thank all of you for support to golf services over the years, to the previous members of the Innovation Committee and to council as a whole. It's been an absolutely wonderful experience.
Thank you. Thank you for your
service. We appreciate it.
So we'll first do the motion on the capital budget.
Okay.
And then we would move a motion on the operating budget.
Okay.
Madam, on the capital budget, I'm going to move a $300,000 reduction in the Innovation Capital Fund allocation and to back out of the previously committed project to fund Wi-Fi on buses and to move that cash to capital back into operating to reduce the impacts of the cuts to Winnipeg Transit on the operating side for 2017.
Okay,
or 2018.
There's a few things there. Could you?
Okay. So the first is a $300
reduction. $300,000
reduction. Reduction in the Innovation Capital Fund. The second one is?
That the funds be recaptured from
captured? That the 300,000.
Right. We move from capital back into operating to go towards additional operating revenues for Winnipeg Transit, and that the Wi-Fi initiative be halted.
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
The Wi-Fi pilot project be.
Okay.
Be what?
What? That the Wi-Fi
be canceled.
Project be canceled. Okay. Thank you.
Why? Now, so I'd like to get Michael Laguerre up then to talk so that people understand what that, there's been some miscommunication about what the Wi-Fi on the buses is doing, and just in terms of the safety and the PEGO issues and how we're looking at moving people more efficiently. Can you talk about the Wi-Fi on the buses, because there's been some miscommunication?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So the objective of the pilot for the it's called Wi-Fi on buses, but what it is really is high-speed communications to the bus. So that enables public safety and driver safety initiatives, like the cameras on the buses. It allows for real-time access to the bus location. It allows for real-time access to the PEGO system. So currently, a PEGO card can take up to 24 hours to be identified on the bus to be used. Instead, it will be real time. So those are the core things. It's about creating a real time infrastructure, high speed infrastructure that allows the buses to become more useful in a number of different ways. The least of which is actually the Wi-Fi part, which gets discussed publicly quite a bit. But again, even there, we're testing out the capability to turn public Wi-Fi on or off. By default, right now, what the pilot preparation has shown, it's not about Netflix on buses. It's about providing that real-time access to the infrastructure and the asset, the bus, and adding a minimum amount of, I'll call it, life safety support. So an individual who doesn't have high-speed phone service, they can connect to Wi-Fi to do basic text messaging, you know, communicate with their family about where they are, where they're going. And limit things like the high speed use of Netflix and those other elements. So that is the core objective. So it's more about enabling the transit service structure we have available, and then also making it more responsive if there's a requirement to reduce number of buses on routes a route allocation, we can do more with less physical buses on routes. So that's a bit more context to what it is.
I mean, today you go onto your phone and you look. This is separate from the Wi-Fi, you know, to the public piece, but you can get an update as to the current live, real-time location and arrival of your next bus.
Yeah.
So if you know the bus is supposed to come at 10:22, but it's running late and it's coming at 10:29, you text your stop location. You're at the bus stop.
Yeah.
It tells you that the bus is running 7 minutes late, and somewhat reliably, 7 minutes late, it shows up.
Yeah.
What kind of radios are on the buses today? And if we're saying, if we're canceling those data plans, can we not?
Yeah, so it's a fundamental shift in technology. So it's an FM, it's a radio-based technology we're using now. It isn't real-time. It's every few minutes is a more accurate description. The simulation we see on the app, or even in some of the transit services, you'll see the bus gracefully going down a route, and every once in a while, blip, it goes back or goes forward, and that's the radio's talking. So it's not real time, but it's quick, and it's an older technology, so we can't share high bandwidth things. You can't share a picture from a security camera across it. So it's moving to a new style high bandwidth phone package that enables it. So it's the other, I guess really the key difference is the speed and scalability of the technology, but also the survivability. The current FM radio systems we have, the end of life is within the next 5 years. So this would get us into the new platforms we require to maintain the service for 5 to 25 years.
I guess what kind of concerns me is, I mean, we saw what a debacle the Farebox rollout was, and how many years and how much over budget that was. What kind of assurances? I mean, there's probably different models and different products that transit authorities are using for their back end side of it. I mean, there's, you know, obviously we're talking about the public front end, yeah, Wi-Fi, so that you don't, like you say, you know, whether it's Netflix or if it's Facebook or basic messaging or whatever.
Yeah.
Versus, you know, the actual operational back-end side of things. What is being proposed and who's using it? Is it being used with our Farebox product?
From as a perspective, for the pilot, we are attempting to see how much value this new technology will bring. Can it be used with the Farebox system? It can. In the pilot, we're going to verify that it adds value. The issue right now with the Farebox in our current system is that it can take up to 24 hours for a bus to receive the new pay information. This will allow it to do it real time. Now, and real time will mean that it should have an update within a minute or two. So you pay for it, you can go on the next bus. That is what the pilot will test. Are we getting value for that? And the same thing with the life safety. You know, working with the drivers and the unions from a driver safety perspective, what's desired, what can work, and what can be expanded upon. So this is not a rollout across the entire transit system. We're spending a limited amount of money on and maximizing the number of technical experiments we can do to see about all the ways you can handle it, from fare boxes, life safety, and then I'll call it the dynamic route management. Can we optimize the use of the buses and drivers we have? So that is the objectives of this limited spend.
Are there examples of other jurisdictions that are using a single data pipe, if you will, or radio modem, or whatever you want to call it,
yes,
that's being shared with both financial transaction information as well as public use?
Yes. Yeah. So the technology has been around for about 7 to 10 years in this current format. The pilot we're testing, you know, most jurisdictions have had it for 2 or 3 years that have this type of technology. So a good example would be there's a similar type of technology being used in Calgary, in Vancouver. So we have some Canadian examples in larger cities. And then in the States, again, New York City has
had. Are they using it for their fare boxes and for security, but are they also letting the public access the Wi-Fi on?
Yes, for emergency services. So, restricted bandwidth options.
Okay.
Now, they're not always turned on. And so this is the interesting piece is the actual use for public Wi-Fi. The other part of the pilot, which we're working on, is do we have to provide the bandwidth for public Wi-Fi use from the bus connectivity, or is there are technologies out there, and that's part of the pilot testing is knowing where the bus is and what local fixed Wi-Fi public use elements are out there. Can we actually tell that person's telephone, the citizen's phone, look, you can connect to this Wi-Fi signal as you're driving down the street here, and then you can connect to this one, and you can connect to this one. So from a bandwidth cost perspective, there's technologies that may allow us to enable public Wi-Fi without having it go across the transit communications network, and may have reduced or zero fees for the city of Winnipeg regarding sharing that public Wi-Fi.
So something other than the cellular network to provide Wi-Fi on buses.
Yes.
I see where you're going.
Yeah, so again, it's back to the pilot. Are these actually feasible? And of course, that particular experiment requires us to understand what public Wi-Fi is available throughout the city, and is it dense enough that it would actually add value for someone? So short answer, there are other municipalities that do use a single data pipe to share multiple public and private traffic. That's not unheard of. We do the same thing even in this room. We have a public Wi-Fi and our city Winnipeg Wi-Fi. So the technology's there. The key element is there an option for us to decost the bandwidth part of it and keep the accessibility there? Or if it has to happen across one pipe, is there minimum value we can bring a citizen? Or is it more just used for internal transit services? Or is it not feasible? Of all the other cost challenges we have, should we delay this type of project expansion throughout transit?
Because if we had one cellular connection, you're not going to have the bus on Netflix.
Absolutely. That's the problem.
Also, too, I think you talked about being able to tell if it's an accessible bus or if it has a bike rack on it, like things like that, that just makes it more user-friendly.
Yeah, so it's a small thing, but would definitely change some of the behaviors of commuters. We have bus racks on the buses, but they have limited capacity. And the challenge right now is if you are going to bike 15 or 20 minutes to a stop, you'd like to know you can get on your bus. Having that real-time access can actually show us, is there...
Is the bike rack full?
Is the bike rack full? Mm-hmm. Small things, but...
Is the bus accessible for...
Absolutely. Is this particular bus the accessible bus I need to get on?
If you look at the book here, this is the first year where 100% of our buses are actually already accessible. Yeah. So yeah. That's not an issue anymore.
Yeah.
Thank goodness.
Anyway.
Yeah. But those are small outcomes that we're going to see and experiment within the pilot, and then be able to evaluate how effective they are.
And safety was a huge issue, so can you just touch base? I know you did a little bit, but what could it do with having the Wi-Fi
again,
in terms of cameras?
Yeah, so some of the options that are being pursued is there are cameras on buses currently, but when there's an emergency situation for a driver or a citizen, the only communication we have with the bus is via radio.
Right.
So they can call in a description of what's going on if they're available. But with this technology, the moment there's an emergency, a panic button gets pressed, or it's a real-time stream, there are a number of options to test. But we can see the images real-time. It doesn't require the driver or citizen who may be in an emergency situation to respond verbally. We can see police dispatch, emergency dispatch could happen quicker and with more information. And the options of doing that, again, that's what we're looking at, is what's available, and then how do we integrate that with our drivers?
Well, again, there's two different things here in my mind. I mean, as a safety initiative, as actually making PIGL work properly, I'm not necessarily against an investment in something. I think it should be coming from the Innovation Capital Fund. In terms of public amenity, I do question the value of the notion that this is going to be a publicly available service, and especially when it looks like, the expectations probably be up here that you're going to have something similar to your home experience when we're not even, that's really far off in terms of, and in terms of even the priorities of where I think the initiative is going is very low. So I have some concerns with both the public expectation as well as the investment at this point. So I move my motion. I'm going to let it stand. I do very much appreciate the very detailed information and anything that's related to safety and that I think is... definitely worth exploring, but not necessarily through this particular proposal that's before us at the moment. And I'll leave my motion as stated.
Further discussion, Chair Gilmore?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay, so I have to admit I'm surprised by this. I didn't know we were having this controversy or conflict with this, Councilor Brawadi, and as by virtue of sort of your concerns over the application of the technology, whether it's worth it at this time.
No, again, this was being sold. This initiative was to be a rollout of public access to the internet on city buses.
Sorry, I'm just going to go for a second, so please don't vote before I get back.
Fair enough.
Hey, we'll keep talking, Councilor Morant. Great, because I got a couple of questions on this.
So this was an opportunity, again, we're in such a desperate position right now where we're talking about dramatic increases to both transit fares as well as reduction in service on the traditional routes. The public I've been hearing from has overwhelmingly been saying, you know, we want basic transit before we have frills like Wi-Fi on buses. A lot of people who use the bus, you know, do have access to at least some amount of data on their wireless devices that they're carrying. And the people I'm talking to suggest this is not a priority. $300,000 isn't going to save transit. It's not going to save the 25-cent fare increase. I recognize that. But this is potentially just one of those pieces that, you know, a small portion of it. If it saves one more bus route, you know, perhaps it's an important piece here. Separately from that, I mean, making sure that the PEGO system is working properly, in my mind, is not what we were sold for that $300,000. A separate initiative through transit to, you know, make PEGO work properly, as well as all sorts of safety options should be on the table, but they should be evaluated in that context.
And like for me, you know, with transit, a big issue this year was safety, better efficiency of the transit system, and the PEGO card. And this pilot project is looking at all three of those things. So for me, it's a very, very important project that we have to keep moving on. Like, as these technologies change, we have to be looking at how we're going to change with them. It really is a big piece of the puzzle moving forward.
So I guess my question, and thank you, Councillor Gilroy, the Wi-Fi for the rider component would be about $300,000, you're saying, Councillor Gilroy?
The pilot project, the one-year pilot project, was previously approved by the Innovation Committee, which through the $1 million Capital Fund had the authorization to do so. To do a one-year trial of starting to implement Wi-Fi on buses. I don't think they're too far down the road. I think we could potentially recapture a bunch of that. So I've moved forward the capital portion of the budget. I endorsed at least the capital budget as far as the purview of the Innovation Committee, less that $300,000 not being rediverted back into operating to help the transit operating budget for 2018.
And I guess my question to the administration, I'm sorry, sir, my first meeting as a member of this standing committee, I don't know your name.
Oh,
sir.
Michael Legere.
Michael?
Legere.
Legere, yeah. Right, okay. So, Mr. Legere, we're talking about a Wi-Fi system. You're talking about a whole system that shows location of the bus. The whole thing's part of a Wi-Fi system?
So again, the core technology is a cellular LTE-based modem. So it's about getting the bus connectivity to a central network.
Okay.
That is the key thing. Once we have that in place, that's what the pilot will install this essentially modem on the bus, and it will allow the bus to talk in a high bandwidth, like a cable modem speed, like at home, talk to a central location in transit, so a number of different things can occur. So once we have that technology in place, that's what the pilot will do, then we can look at the high-speed communication to the bus for PEGO, for real-time access or close to real-time access for cameras, audio, public safety equipment of whatever form. And then additionally, because there's a network, an internet connection that can be created through this pipe, then we can look at what kind of public accessible Wi-Fi could be provided. And so there's an option of having the citizen can connect through that pipe to the internet via the central point. Or the other thing I discussed was understanding, receiving information from a central point about where physical Wi-Fi exists along the bus route, prompt the user's phone to connect to one of those locations as they go through the route. So those are the types of options. So the Wi-Fi component that's discussed, it's all of this gets put in place to test out that Wi-Fi component.
But you're creating a new system anyway. That's correct. You're creating a new electromagnetic infrastructure that will both use hard wiring, hard cabling, as well as electromagnetic transmission the modem. That would be electromagnetic transmission, right? That would be through the air.
Yeah, it's a cell phone.
It's a cell phone. So it'll be going directly to a central point, or we'll be using locators along the route. If you have points along the route to which it sends a signal.
Well, so again, there's a couple layers. There's what the hardware is doing, what that modem, what the cell phone is doing, versus what the virtual network, the internet part does. So there is, if you imagine this this LTE modem on the bus, it's essentially a cell phone, and it can talk to all the bus's systems and share information across the public cell phone service. So it'll be a part of our, be it Bell or be it Rogers, but again, the cell phone provider that we use at the City of Winnipeg, it'll connect to that network as a cell phone, and then it will virtually connect. It'll attach itself, like the same way you get email on your phone from the City of Winnipeg. It'll connect the virtual network to the transit central connection point. So it'll be a direct connection to transit.
But rotor points along the way, if you will.
Cell towers. So again,
cell towers.
Yeah. Okay. So exactly, cell towers are. There's not one for the City of Winnipeg. They're all across the city.
Yeah.
And the modem will connect to this one, and then as the bus drives, connect to that one, move over to that one, move over to that one, move over to that one.
So it'll be able to use all these cell relay towers in the city.
Yeah, it'll work like a regular cell phone would. Okay. It has access everywhere.
But because it's the city gets to... Okay, so it's a regular one, but there will be an agreement with all private cell relay towers. There will be no question over our ability.
No, the piece I'm discussing regarding, well, how could we provide public Wi-Fi without using this connection? Just like cell phone towers, there are a number of different free Wi-Fi points across the city. They're not as well distributed as cell phone towers.
That's the question. Yeah.
So right now, there are technologies available where we can identify where these free Wi-Fi points are and prompt the user's phone. So not the bus and this one there, but the user essentially gets information from the bus saying, look, there's a Wi-Fi connection here that's open. It shares the key for them to get on it. As they move forward, oh, we're coming up to this one, it shares the key. So it allows, it's a new technology that allows, instead of using the cell phone bandwidth for your phone, it lets you attach to these free Wi-Fi points along the way.
Yeah. And these are literally, physically, rotor points.
Yes. Owned and hosted by either existing infrastructure we have or other infrastructure the province or other businesses have provided.
So the question is then, one of them is how I'm trying to figure out the system, the line, the grid of rotor points to which we can attach as the bus goes along its way.
For us, it's discovering them. So discovering again, we won't be building any new ones. We're going to be, there is a number of infrastructure being offered out there for free. It's going to be identifying where those are, making sure we can use them appropriately, and then testing the technology to make that more convenient for the transit user.
So there will be gaps, because the city doesn't intend to fill the gaps of the gaps between the distant road points.
There may be gaps. We don't know yet.
Okay.
But I anticipate gaps.
So the technology that would be employed for the Wi-Fi on the buses for the riders, you're already creating a new system. Councillor Gilroy is talking about safety. You're talking about
getting a live, a pretty live understanding of the transit route in progress. This is new technology that you're creating for Winnipeg Transit, but that you're putting in place.
It's a standard technology used by municipalities across Canada and the United States, but it's something we do not currently have ourselves.
But it's separate. This is the question for me: whether if this infrastructure you're putting in could be used for rider Wi-Fi, that's one thing. But if the rider Wi-Fi is a completely different infrastructure, then it's worth.
Well, it requires both. So basically for the rider Wi-Fi options that may be available, yeah. One, using city infrastructure to allow them access to the internet, whatever bandwidth level, Netflix or text messaging. That's an option one, it needs this infrastructure. That second option of using that public Wi-Fi system would still require the central point to share route information, router information, access information. So either one would still require the base technology we're talking about here.
That you're implementing at this time.
Councilor Schreier, Councilor Morantz has been waiting for a while, so I'll make sure he gets a question in.
No, that's okay. I want to thank you for giving that full explanation of the program, because I think it has largely been characterized as just Wi-Fi on buses, but it's so much more than that. And I have to say, and as my colleagues know, we have a very serious situation we're dealing with around safety on buses for our operators and our passengers, and I think that this pilot project will hopefully have the result of enhancing our ability to make the riding experience safer through the real-time cameras and so forth. So I think that's an extremely important part of this project. I do respectfully disagree with the characterization of PEGO as a debacle. I've followed that program very, very closely. There have been literally millions of uses. I think the last update I had was in September. There had been over 5 million individual taps back then, and something like maybe 1,000 complaints, which is statistically insignificant compared to the number of users. The real issue around PEGO, as you've accurately described, is that the initial software didn't include the ability to have a real-time update to the cards when people loaded them on their home computers. So if you went to one of the stores to do it, it would happen right away because there was a real-time link. So with this technology, if it were to be implemented, also has the potential of actually allowing a real-time upload to buses when you are actually uploading money to your PEGO card at home. And that would, I think, go a long way to alleviate the minimal number of complaints we've had around that issue. So it's far more than just Wi-Fi on buses, and other cities are doing it. And this is the Innovation Committee again. So I think this is a very worthwhile idea to study. I'm sure now that we've had this discussion, the public will have a fuller understanding of what the program is really for. So. I think you could probably guess by my comments that I respectfully will not be supporting my colleague's motion, but I think this has been a very valuable discussion.
Okay. All right. I can read the motion. Unless there's
I have a comment to make. Do I make my comment now or are we after the vote?
On the matter, it would be now.
Yeah. Right. I'd like to make a comment. Okay. Based on this serious issue, and I certainly don't blame Councilor Berwati for making the issue of, more buses or more innovation research. I put it down to this: it is a serious issue. That money could go towards buses. We've got a severe systemic problem with Winnipeg Transit in terms of ridership and costs, and we're reducing buses to deal with this. But it's an issue of reliability and dependability of and regularity of something that Winnipeggers depend on in order to have confidence in a public transit system that they're going to use. The issue of whether the money should go into more buses, that's a fair one. Excuse the pun. So in this case, I'm looking at it this way. I'm making my decision this way. The cost would be $300,000 for for the research on this? Is that the number?
Yes, the cost covers some consultative research aspects and a minimum set of hardware for six buses.
Okay. So the potential for this could be great. I'm putting down to this. 300, this is, I know this is very simple. I'm going to put it out there, and I can be ridiculed. For less than an increase of around 200 riders per year, 200 people becoming regular riders, less than that, that's worth it in terms of the revenue. So I'm saying putting Wi-Fi in buses, yeah, that'll increase ridership by more than 200 riders, especially young people per year, which is especially what we're trying to look for in terms of younger people using our transit system. I'm basing it on a very vague estimate, but that's where I'm going with, and on that basis, I won't be supporting Councillor Berwadi's motion.
All right, so there's a motion. Do you want to read the motion?
I'll read the motion. I've had time to clean it up. Councillor Berwadi moved that the capital budget be approved with the following amendment, that the Capital Innovation Fund Transit Enhancement and Wi-Fi Pilot Project on Winnipeg Transit Buses in the amount of $300,000 be cancelled and said monies be moved to the Winnipeg Transit 2018 operating budget. Did I capture?
Perfect.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Nay.
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 The motion is okay. Lost.
Yeah. A good point.
Okay. And
now we need a new motion for the...
Yeah, so if you want to approve it as submitted or if there are other amendments that
would
be made.
If there are no other amendments, I would, what's the appropriate language for the...
Be approved as submitted, that the preliminary 2018 capital budget and preliminary 2018 capital project detail budget under the committee's purview be approved as submitted.
Okay, I will adopt that language without reiterating it.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Nay.
Would you like to be recorded in opposition?
All right. And does somebody want to move consent and adjournment?
So we actually, we now have to do the operating.
Oh, that's right. Oh. Correct. Yes. Yeah. Oh. Yes. Okay.
So somebody, if there are no amendments, the motion would be that the preliminary 2018 operating budget under the committee's purview be approved as submitted.
I will adopt that language without reiterating it.
Okay, all those.
I wish to make a comment at this time.
Sure.
Yeah, like water and waste a couple of days ago, I'm voting in favor of this just because I respect the process and the very serious work involved over the past year by the standing committee as well as the members of administration involved in preparing this budget. It's a serious piece of work and a lot of dedication went into it, and I respect that. Having said that, I will be voting in favor of this, but I have not voted on the budget yet. I have not made my decision yet, and I wish to make my decision holistically in terms of how various departments interrelate. And on this basis, this is not an indication of my favor of this in terms of the budget as a whole, but just in terms of the serious work involved in creating this, by which I get to make a decision at budget time.
Okay, thank you. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Carried.
Nay.
Okay.
I'll move adjournment.
Okay. Thank you very much.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Carried.
Always fun, eh?
Always fun.
Thank you. Thanks for the information.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, no worries.
It's about the ability, to partner with.